Good evening, everyone. How are you? Good. I see a wonderful crowd downstairs and upstairs as well. I'm Ron Richard, President and CEO of the Cleveland Foundation, and I am delighted to welcome you to the 77th Annual Anisfield-Wolf Book Awards. I like to think of this event as the world's largest, yet most exclusive and prestigious book club. Although we meet only once a year, how many other book clubs have the distinction of hosting the authors of the featured books? How many other book clubs have the distinction of deriving from the philanthropic vision of one woman who realized the power of literature to advance the ongoing dialogue about race, culture, ethnicity, and our shared humanity? Oprah, eat your heart out. I'm so pleased that all of our 2012 honorees were able to carve time out of their very hectic schedules to be here with us tonight. We are graced by their presence and by your presence. Once again, Clevelanders validated our town's reputation for passion about literature with a sellout of this beautiful venue, our home, for a second year. Almost immediately after nearly 1,000 tickets became available, they were scooped up. Your enthusiasm for this event is deeply gratifying, not only to the board and staff of the Cleveland Foundation, but to the dedicated jurors who selected our winners and to the authors we will hear from in just a little bit. We're pleased to have a broad national and even international audience listening to this program, which we're streaming live, courtesy of a collaboration between Playhouse Square and IdeaStream. At least I can assure you that my parents and four siblings are tuning in from Washington, D.C., Florida, San Francisco, and London, England, respectively. Our ceremony is being carried on ideastream.org and, for the first time, on Anisfield-Wolf.org. It will be archived on both websites. If you haven't yet visited the Anisfield-Wolf site, please do yourself a favor and check it out. It's incredible. In addition to this year's authors, this dynamic site contains information on every winning author and title since the awards were presented in 1936. It also includes a multimedia library of print, audio, video materials, and a community blog that invites your comments. So please join the conversation. It's easy and it's fun. We're delighted that C-SPAN 2's Book TV is here filming tonight. Another first for us, one of my favorite TV shows, I want you to know. Each weekend, Book TV features top authors, books, and publishing events. Thanks to Book TV, an even wider audience will be able to experience and appreciate this marvelous event. Now, as a fitting preamble to this evening's celebration of contemporary literary craftsmanship, let's treat ourselves to a glimpse of future achievement in letters. 4 years ago, we started a new tradition of recognizing an emerging young poet from Northeast Ohio. Tonight, we welcome Isabella Rodriguez, a third grader at Walls Elementary School in Kent. Isabella will recite for us the poem she wrote at Kent State University's WIC Poetry Center, which nurtures talent in its workshops for non-professional writers. The center's staff selected her poem among its 2012 traveling stanzas, which appear in businesses, schools, hospitals, and libraries throughout Ohio. Isabella's teacher, Nicole Robinson, is also the center's outreach coordinator. Ms. Robinson is here tonight, as are Isabella's proud mother, Natasha Rodriguez, and her stepfather, Matthew Carroll, right here. And you must be doing something right, as we'll all see in a minute. As Ms. Robinson wrote in an email, children have a wild and beautiful imagination. I think you'll agree Isabella's lyrical verse is clear proof of that statement. In fact, speaking from the heart, let me say that I cannot tell you in words how touched I was when I first heard Isabella's poem. I was amazed that a third grader could write such a mature and moving piece. On the screen behind us, you can see her poem and the design that it inspired by Devin Skunta Helmick, a visual communication design student at Kent State. So now, without further ado, allow me to present Isabella Rodriguez with a reading of Home. Sweetheart. You can come over here, darling.
Home. Suppose there is a city in the Buddha's lap, and his knees are the mountains singing. Suppose feathers rejoice when they fall from the eagle's wing, spinning and dancing. Suppose nature is a map leading to willow trees, where spirits roam, speaking in old voices. Suppose you can climb rocks like a billy goat, with clanking hooves and horns that curl for battle. Suppose a path of dandelions and buttercups takes you back to the mountain, where you call out, I'm home.
Thank you, Isabella. I know I'm not the only one left mesmerized by your youthful wisdom. Please join me in another round of applause for our superbly gifted homegrown poet. And we'll make sure that Isabella's poem is on the website so that you can all read it, print it out, and have a copy. Just a month ago, the London Summer Olympic Games drew to a close. No matter how you feel about this quadrennial extravaganza, which usually generates a little controversy and criticism, it also inspires joy and awe at the athletic prowess on display, and maybe something else. I think it stirs a wistful yearning. Watching the athletes of more than 200 nations march into the stadium at the opening, we can't help but wish this peaceful, multicultural assembly was the rule and not the exception in our world. Sadly, the Olympics are the candy coating on international relations, as we've seen in the last few days in Cairo and Libya. The wars we wage on real battlefields are not games, and the consequences are far more dire than finishing out of medal competition. Wars play a prominent role in all three titles we're honoring tonight. Our Civil War in David Blight's American Oracle, World War II in Essay Idugin's Half-Blood Blues, combat in general and the welter of emotions that killing breeds in David Livingstone Smith's Less Than Human. From nuclear saber rattling in Iran and North Korea, to civil war in Syria, to the train wreck that is Afghanistan, to dozens of small-scale conflicts in Africa, we keep annihilating or threatening to annihilate one another with clockwork regularity. But war represents failure, no matter how we dress it up, as valorous exploits or defense of national honor, race, ethnicity, culture, religion, or political system. Our authors expose this truth as they seek to understand what David Blight refers to in his chapter on Robert Penn Warren as, quote, the violence in the human heart, unquote. And war, as David Smith reminds us, depends upon viewing the enemy as the other, dehumanized and degraded. It's easier to persecute or kill when your adversary is reduced to subhuman level. These days, most of us pay scant attention to armed conflicts far from our shores, perhaps because there are just so many of them. We haven't always been so inured to mass killing, nor in our domestic politics have we always been so intransigent, so unwilling to cede legitimacy to those who disagree with us. Our own rhetorical civil war rages now, and if we don't dehumanize the other side, well, we certainly demonize it with gusto. We live in an age of extremism, and the rare political leader who favors negotiation and compromise is vanishing. Witness the abrupt retirement of 9-term Ohio Congressman Steve LaTourette, a moderate and very decent and honorable man. The war of words will only escalate as the November election nears, we can be sure of that. It's been playing out for months already in our swing state living rooms. It almost makes you nostalgic for ads with talking babies and rapid-fire recitals of prescription drug side effects. And this isn't in the script, but you know what I'm talking about. You know those ads that say, if you have something lasting more than 4 hours, call your doctor? So where does all this leave us, fellow citizens? How do we counter the violence and vitriol that saturate humankind? How do we strike a blow for civility in a brutal world? I'd answer with another question, which is, what would Edith Anisfield-Wolf have us do? Edith was a published poet who knew the power of language. To her, literature was a vehicle for exposing racial prejudice and celebrating human diversity. Her enlightened views are all the more remarkable when you remember she was born in 1889 and died in 1963, 7 months before the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. delivered his immortal I Have a Dream speech. Edith was always hopeful. She believed if we opened ourselves to learning from and about each other, old fears and stereotypes would wither, and we would begin at last to embrace rather than deny our shared humanity. The great historian Barbara Tuchman called books humanity in print. In her 1978 epic, A Distant Mirror, Tuchman takes us back to the 14th century, a low watermark in human history when the Hundred Years' War dragged on and the Black Death wiped out nearly a third of the population between India and Iceland in just 2 years. Finally, the forces of destruction played themselves out and the shroud of gloom began to lift. Tuchman writes that the fall of Byzantium in 1453 is generally regarded as the end of the Middle Ages. But, and I quote, an event more pregnant with change took place at the same time. The first document printed from movable type was produced by Gutenberg at Mainz. The Gothic sun, as Victor Hugo put it with fitting grandiloquence, set behind the giant printing press of Mainz. The advent of the printing press was what we would now call a disruptive technology. Once people could rapidly disseminate knowledge and exchange ideas, the world was forever changed. This is our legacy, whether we read the written word on paper or on a Kindle. What matters is that we keep reading, learning, and stretching our understanding. The Olympic motto is catchy, sort of, faster, higher, stronger. But maybe it's time we champion a different motto, which is literacy, diversity, and civility. That's what tonight's honorees represent. Let's take a page from their books. Now I'd like to acknowledge a few special guests, starting with Charles Bolton, the deeply dedicated chair of the Cleveland Foundation's Board of Directors, and my boss, Mr. Bolton. I also want to salute all of our current and past board members who are in attendance tonight. I have the distinct honor of sharing this stage with the Anisfield-Wolf Jury Chair and our longtime MC, our dear friend, the inimitable Dr. Henry Louis Gates, Jr. of Harvard. Familiar to so many of us, of course, as just Skip. We're especially pleased to have Skip with us tonight because he was sidelined last year by a nasty virus. So Skip, welcome back to Cleveland. And what a thrill it is to have a second jury member with us, Akron native Rita Dove, in the front row there. Former Poet Laureate of the United States, and a recipient of the 2011 National Medal of Arts and the 1996 National Humanities Medal, among countless other honors. Rita's here with her husband, our friend, Fred Vibon. Rita, could you and Fred please stand and get a rousing Cleveland greeting? Thank you. For more than 200 submitted works, Skip, Rita, and three other widely published academics on our esteemed Anisfield-Wolf jury selected one novel and two volumes of nonfiction that met their exacting standards for this singular prize. The jury also chose a Lifetime Achievement Award winner, who is no stranger to the Anisfield-Wolf Book Awards because he received one for nonfiction in 1987. Tonight, we'll hear the insights and celebrate the achievements of the 2012 Anisfield-Wolf honorees. Essay, Edujin, author of Half-Blood Blues, receives the fiction prize. David Blight, author of American Oracle, The Civil War in the Civil Rights Era, and David Smith, author of Less Than Human, Why We Demean, Enslave, and Exterminate Others, share the nonfiction prize. Our Lifetime Achievement Award goes to Arnold Rampersad, award-winning biographer whose works include The Art and Imagination of W.E.B. Du Bois, Jackie Robinson, a biography, Ralph Ellison, a biography. And the two-volume opus, The Life of Langston Hughes, widely considered the definitive biography of the poet, playwright, and novelist who moved to Cleveland in his teens and began developing as a serious writer while he attended Central High School. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the part you really came here for, it's my great pleasure to turn the program over to our wonderful jury chair and tonight's MC, our dear friend, Dr. Henry Louis Gates.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Ron. I don't know if you all know, I didn't even recognize him. The man's lost 40 pounds. You know, really, it's amazing. 38 pounds in 40 days, right? That is, man, I need to check in the Cleveland Clinic. But before we go on, let's give it up to Isabella. I mean, could you have done that in the second grade? Written that poem, then performed? Isabella, you are bad, but that means good. And Rita Dove, if I were you, I'd be quaking in my boots. Now I know why you showed up. You know, she never comes. We added this, and then she showed up out of the blue. That's why. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. Good evening, my friends. It's great to be back in Cleveland. I love Cleveland. I got a thing in my heart for Cleveland, Ohio. Give it up to yourself. and welcome to the 77th annual Anisfield-Wolf Book Awards. And this is our 16th ceremony to be held publicly. Before that time, it was just done through the mail. Our 16th ceremony, and what a lovely ceremony it is each year, one to which I look forward to co-hosting with Ron every year. And this, by the way, is Ron's 10th year as head of the Cleveland Foundation. And what a remarkable 10 years it's been, hasn't it? Ron, thanks for all that you do for Cleveland and all that you've done to ensure that Edith Anisfield Wolf's commitment, a visionary commitment incredibly made 3/4 of a century ago to honoring such an odd thing, excellence in the literary and scholarly explorations of cultural diversity. In that you have ensured that this vision, this crazy idea, has not only been protected, it has been nurtured, it has been expanded, it's been fulfilled in ways that Edith Anisfield Wolf scarcely could have imagined. Let's give it up for Ron Richard. These awards are chosen each year by a stellar jury composed of the poet Rita Dove, the novelist Joyce Carol Oates, the psychologist Steven Pinker, my colleague, and the historian Simon Chama. This award has always been a major national book prize with a host of outstanding previous winners, including, among so many others, Langston Hughes, Zora Neale Hurston, and even the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And now, thanks to the vision, commitment, and sheer energy of one person, we now have a hot website and live streaming video of our event, national press coverage, and several supporting lectures and presentations. And you all know who that one person is, and she's the lifeblood of the Anisfield-Wolf Book Awards, my dear friend and comrade, Mary Louise Hahn. Give it up for Mary Louise. Stand up, Mary Louise. Our annual ceremony has become an important event on Cleveland's social and intellectual calendar, and that takes an entire team of people to pull off, including Ron, of course, but also Cindy Schultz. Cindy, please stand up. And the 6 other team members who have worked for months to create this evening. Give it up to Cindy and her team. As Mary Louise put it to me just yesterday, and I quote in an email, making sure I was going to be here, you know, she emailed me 3 times and then called me when I was on the plane. I mean, it was terrible. I was coming. I stopped to get my shoe shine. She almost had a heart attack. I am quoting from her email to show her that I do read them, even if I do ignore them. Edith Anisfield Wolf, she wrote, who was a quiet and reserved person, would be astonished and thrilled with how many people across the country now understand her resolve to open minds, to the rich diversity of human cultures and the tragedy and waste of prejudice and hatred. It's an honor to serve as chair of the jury and to play even a modest role in fulfilling Edith's belief in the miracle of the cultural diversity of the human community, a diversity that these awards are committed to nourishing and protecting. So thank you for honoring me with this assignment. And now, let's get on to the reason that you've come here to meet this year's honorees. It is showtime, ladies and gentlemen. Essie Edugin. This is the miracle of phonetic spelling, ladies and gentlemen. If you saw this text, you wouldn't even recognize this child's name. Whipping from Baltimore to Berlin to Paris, Half-Blood Blues is Essie Edugin's story of a character called Hieronymus Hero Falk, an Afro-German trumpet player, and his band called the Hot Time Swingers, as they leave Berlin in 1939 for occupied Paris, where Falk is arrested by the Nazis for the crime of being an Afro-German jazz musician. Degenerate, both by birth, because he's one of the Rhineland bastards, so-called, produced by the unions of German women and French colonial soldiers after World War I, and degenerate by choice, because the Nazis considered jazz to be a degenerate art form, a quote-unquote Jewish Hottentot frivolity. Think about that as an insult. A Jewish Hottentot frivolity. Falk is the central figure of this novel, which has been praised to the heavens, and which uses a little exposed, which uses a little explored corner of the African diaspora to address themes of creativity, community, betrayal and preservation of itself, relations to the other, and the very nature of both historical memory and historical discourse. The novel is powered not only by its flights from place to place and person to person, but also, and I would say most impressively, by S.E. Oduggin's brilliant use of black vernacular. Vernacular language, the common language spoken by a people, has powered African-American fiction for more than a century. Think just of Charles Chestnut, Gene Toomer and Langston Hughes, Zora Neale Hurston, Ohio's Toni Morrison. The language their characters speak becomes almost a character itself. Vernacular is an expression of reclamation, belonging, of identity, and most certainly of place. It's also an assertion of authority over a particular story. It establishes the storyteller, if you think about it, as the master of the story, as the definer of her or his own terms. The story is about hero, ostensibly, but it is narrated by the bassist, Sid Griffiths, who has his own bones to pick and his own story to tell. Oduggin's language in the book is itself a hybrid, a mischling, to use the derogatory German term, for half-breeds, quote unquote, and what Sid himself calls mongrel talk. She draws from the well-recorded patois of the time. Women are Janes and male musicians were Gates. I'd rather like that myself. Because they swing like Gates. But invents her own as well. In Sid's retelling, Nazis are the boots. Oduggin has called this blending of history's language and her own one of the genuine pleasures of writing this book. Indeed, it is one of the features of the book that critics have most resoundingly praised as well. Sam Sachs in the Wall Street Journal hailed the novel's entrancing period piece ventriloquism, as he put it. The critic in The Independent in the UK wrote, and I quote, "The novel is truly extraordinary in its shimmering jazz vernacular, its pitch-perfect male banter, and its period slang." Oduggin, he continues, never stumbles with her storytelling, not even over one sentence. I'm sometimes leery, I have to confess, of comparisons of writing to jazz. When a critic writes, as one has about Half-Blood Blues, that its prose is, quote, velvety, fluid, and hip as jazz, I agree, but I worry that that formulation is too easy, too trite. However, in the case of this novel, it happens to be more than apt. As the judges for the Scotiabank Giller Award wrote, quote, "It's conventional to liken the prose in novels about jazz to the music itself, as though there could be no higher praise. In this case," they continue, "say rather that any jazz musician would be happy to play the way Oduggin writes." Her style is deceptively conversational and easy, they continue, but with the simultaneous exuberance and discipline of a true prodigy. Put this book next to Louis Armstrong's West End Blues, these two works of art belong together, unquote. In the words of a Guardian UK review, Oduggin really can write, which helps to explain why this book has won numerous awards. In addition to the Scotiabank Prize, Canada's most prestigious award for fiction in English, Half-Blood Blues won the 2012 Ethel Wilson Fiction Prize and was shortlisted for both the 2011 Man Booker Prize and the 2012 Orange Prize for Fiction, among many others. It was selected by the New York Times Book Review as an editor's choice, by the Globe and Mail as a best book of the year, and for comparable honors by Amazon, by Quill and Quire, the San Francisco Chronicle, to name just a few. Half-Blood Blues is Oduggin's second novel. The first, The Second Life of Samuel Tyne, was named one of 2004's Books to Remember by the New York Public Library. It was nominated for the Hurston Wright Legacy Award and is part of Knopf's Canada's New Face of Fiction program. Born of Ghanaian parents, or as they say in my beloved Nigeria, Ghanaian parents, in Calgary, and making her home now in Victoria, Idugin has held residencies in Spain, in Iceland, and in Germany. She's a writer who the Globe and Mail says promises to lead black literature in a whole new direction. And I happen to agree with that. For her evocation, for her evocation of a time and a place that are entrenched in our imaginations through the language that they use, even as they defy our imaginations, and for her illumination of people upon whom too little historical or literary light has been shown, Essie Idugin is awarded the Anisfield-Wolf Book Award for Fiction for her stunning and startling novel, Half-Blood Blues.
So honored to be receiving this award tonight. To be associated with this long, distinguished list of amazing writers who've won this before, it's just, incredible. And also to be associated with everything that this award embraces and stands for, it's just, I'm terribly honored. So I'll be reading from Half-Blood Blues tonight, and I will start at the beginning, so as not to give anything away. And Dr. Gates did a beautiful job of introducing, the themes of the novel, so I'll just start right in. So, Paris, 1940. Chip told us not to go out. Said, "Don't you boys tempt the devil." But it'd been one brawl of a night, I tell you. All of us still reeling from the rot. Rot was cheap, see, the drink of French peasants. But it stayed like nails in your gut. Didn't even look right, all mossy and black in the bottle, like drinking swamp water. See, we lay exhausted in the flat, sheets nailed over the windows. Sunrise so fierce it seeped through the gaps, dropped like cloth on our skin. A couple hours before, we was playing in some back alley studio, trying to cut a record. A grim little room, more like a closet of ghosts than any joint for music. The cracked heaters lisping steam, empty bottles rolling all over the warped floor. Our cigarettes glowed like small holes in the dark, and that's how I known we wasn't buzzing. Hero smoke not moving or nothing. The cig just sitting there in his mouth like he couldn't hear his way clear. Everyone pacing about, listening between takes to the scrabble of rats in the wall. Restless as hell. Now, could be we wasn't so rotten, but I, at least, felt off. Too nervous, too crazed, too busy watching the door. Forget the rot. Forget the studio's seclusion. Nothing tore me out in myself. Take after take, I play sweating to the end of it, only to have Hero scratch the damn disc, tossing it in the trash. Just a damn braid of mistakes, Hero kept muttering. A damn braid of mistakes. We sound like royalty, after the mob got done with him, said Chip. Coleman and I ain't said nothing, our heads hanging tiredly. But Hero, wiping his horn with a blacked up handkerchief, he turned and gave Chip a look of pure spite. Well, yeah, but hell, even at our worst, we genius. Did that ever stun me, him saying this? For weeks the kid been going on and on about how dreadful we sound. He kept snatching at the discs, scratching the lacquer with a pocket knife, wrecking them, yelling how there wasn't nothing there. But there was something, some seed of twisted beauty. I didn't mean to, but somehow, when the kid turned his back, I was sliding off my vest, taking the last disc, still delicate, the groove still new, and folding the fabric around it. I glanced around, nervous, then tucked it into my base case. The others was packing up their axes. "Where's that last record at?" said Hero, frowning. He peered at the trash bin, at the damaged discs all in there. "It's in there, Buck," I said. "You didn't want it, did you?" He gave me a sour look. "Ain't no damn point. We ain't never gonna get this right." "What you saying, kid?" said Chip, slurring his words. "You saying we should give it up?" The kid just shrugged. We lined up the empty bottles along the wall, locked up real quiet, gone our separate routes back to Delilah's flat. Curfew was on, and Paris was grim, all clotted shadows and stale air. I made my quiet way along the alleys, dreading the sound of footsteps, till we met up again at the flat. We collapsed onto dirty couches under blackout curtains. I'd set my axe against the wall, and it was like I could feel the damn disc just sitting in there, still warm. I felt its presence so intensely, it seemed strange the others ain't sensed it too. Its wax holding all that heat like an altar candle. A couple months before, we'd spent the day nailing black sheets across the flat's windows, but damn if that grim sun didn't flood through anyway. The rooms felt too stale to sober up in. We needed to sweat it out in the fresh air, get our heads about us. Ain't been no breeze in weeks. Hero was draped in his chair, his scrawny legs dangling, when all of a sudden he turned to me, his face dark and smooth as an eggplant. "Christ, I feel green. My guts are pure gravy, man." "Amen," I said. "Man, I got to get me some milk." "Amen," I said again. We talked like mongrels, see. Half German, half Baltimore bar slang. Just a few scraps of French between us. Only real language I spoke aside from English was Hochdeutsch. But once I started messing up the words, I couldn't straighten nothing out again. Besides, I known Hero preferred it this way. Kid hailed from the Rhineland, sure, but he got old Baltimore in the blood, or talked like he did. He was still young that way, mimicking. Something had changed in him lately, though. He ain't hardly et nothing since the boots descended on the city, been laid up feverish and slack for days on end. And when he come to, there was this new darkness in him I ain't never seen before. I gave my old axe a quick glance, thinking of the record tucked away in there. It wasn't guilt I felt. Well, not that exactly. Hero sort of half rolled under the patchy rug. "Aw, Sid," he groaned. "I need milk." "In the cupboard, I reckon." Hero coughed. "I'm trying to clean my stomach, not rough it up." His left eye twitched all high up in the lid, the way you sometimes see the heart of a thin woman beating through her blouse. "It's milk I need, brother. Cream. That powdered stuff will rip right through you, like you shit in sand. Like you a damn hourglass." "Aw, it ain't that bad," I said. "Ain't nothing open at this hour anyway, kid. You know that. Except maybe the coup. But that's too damn far." We lay on in silence a minute. In the bad light, I could just make out the room's last few chairs huddled by the fireplace. They looked absurd, like a flock of geese hiding from the hatchet. Because they was the last of it, see. This has been a grand old flat, to go by Lila's stories. All Louis XIV chairs, Murano chandeliers, Aubusson tapestries, ceilings high as a damn train station. But the count who lent Delilah the place, he'd unearth her to sell what she could before the crowds come in. Seemed less bleak to him. And now, the flat being so empty, you felt only its depths, like you stranded at sea. Whole place nothing but darkness. I glanced over at Hero, now all knotted up in his chair. "Kid," I said thickly. "Hey, kid." I put a hand to my head. "You ain't serious about giving up on the record. We close, Buck. You know that." He didn't seem to have heard me. I watched him heave himself up on his feet, the chair moaning like an old mule. Then he sort of staggered on over to the door. At least I reckon that was his idea. Looked more like he heading for the fireplace, stumbling all about. His shoulder smacked a wall. Then he was on the floor, on all fours. "What you doing?" I said. "Hero, what you doing, kid?" "What you mean, what am I doing? You ain't never seen a man put on his shoes before? Well, stick around, because it's about to get exciting. I'm going to put my damn coat on next." Hero was wrestling his old houndstooth coat. It'd gone all twisted in the sleeves. He still ain't stood up. I need me some daylight right about now. I pulled on my fob, stared at my watch till it made damn sense. "This ain't no kind of hour, kid. You ain't yourself. You being a damn fool. You know you don't got any papers. What you gonna do you get stopped?" He shrugged. "I just going down the bugs. It ain't far." He yanked open the door and slid out onto the landing, swaying in the half dark. Staring into the shadows there, I felt sort of uneasy. Don't know why. Well, the bug was our name for the tobacconist a few blocks away, and it wasn't far. All right," I muttered. "Hold up, I'm coming." I stumbled up, fumbling for my other shoe. And then we were slipping down those wide marble stairs in the dark and pushing out into the gray street. We usually went all of nowhere in the daytime. Never without Delilah, never the same route twice, and not ever into Rue des Saussets or Avenue Foch. But Hero, he'd grown reckless as the occupation deepened. He was a Mischling, a half-breed, but so dark no soul ever liked to guess his mama a white Rhinelander. Hell, his skin glistened like pure oil, but he German-born, sure. And if his face wasn't of the fatherland, well, just about everything else about him rooted him there right good. And add to this the fact that he didn't have no identity papers right now, well, let's just say it wasn't no cakewalk for him. Me? I was American, and so light-skinned folks often took me for white. Son of two Balmore quadroons, I come out straight-haired, green-eyed, a right little Spaniard. In Balmore, this give me a softer ride than some. I'd be lying if I said it ain't back in Berlin, too. When we gone out together in that city, anyone approaching us always come straight to me. When Hero'd cut in with his native German, well, the gent would damn near die of surprise. Most ain't liked it, though. A savage talking like he's civilized. You'd see that old glint in their eye, like a knife turning. We fled to Paris to outrun all that, but we known Lila's gutted flat wouldn't fend off the chaos forever. Ain't no man can outrun his fate. Sometimes, when I looked out through the curtains, staring onto the emptiness of Rue de Veyron, I'd see our old Berlin. I'd see that night when all of the glass on our street shattered. We'd been in Ernst's flat on Fasanenstrasse, messing it up. And when we drifted over to the curtains, it was like looking down on a carnival. Crowds in the firelight, broken bottles. We'd gone down after a minute, and it was like walking on a gravel path, all them shards crunching at each step. The synagogue up the block was on fire. We watched firemen standing with their backs to the flames, spraying water on all the other buildings to keep the fire from spreading, see. I remember the crowd been real quiet. A firelight was shining on the wet streets, the hose water running into the drains. Here and there, I seen teeth glowing like opals on the black cobblestones. Thank you very much.
Beautiful. Thank you, Essie. David Livingston Smith. David Livingston Smith has long been a student of some of humankind's baser impulses. His 2004 book, Why We Lie, The Evolutionary Roots of Deception and the Unconscious Mind, drew on his training in the philosophy of mind, psychology, and psychoanalysis to examine the inevitability of deception. We are wired for it. In 2007, he explored the bellicose tendencies of humans in the most dangerous animal, human nature, and the origins of war. It seems that we are wired for that too. Less than human, why we demean, enslave, and exterminate others, one of our two nonfiction winners tonight brings history, psychology, biology, anthropology, and philosophy to bear on the phenomenon of dehumanization, the practice of one group, the practice by one group of rendering another group subhuman. Needless to say, even if dehumanization takes on particular cultural forms, it is nonetheless as ancient as humanity, in his argument, and is what he calls a joint creation of biology, culture, and the architecture of the human mind. It's not difficult to think of far too many examples from the 20th century alone of words that have been used to dehumanize and indeed to kill. Vermin, cockroaches, and dogs have, we've been told by the aggressors, populated the human landscapes of Nazi Germany, of Rwanda, of the Sudan, and the Middle East, to name just a few of the most glaring examples. In reading Smith's analysis of this language and thinking about the human tendency to treat groups of people not as people but as animals, one wonders if there is any other species that needs to make its enemies not only lesser, that would seem to be the law of the jungle as it were, but categorically different as well. We can certainly see this radical dehumanization in our own history. Black slaves were not only less than, but were fundamentally different than their white slave owners. Never remaining wholly in the realm of either philosophy or psychology, but always drawing examples from our own experience in the world, Smith argues that if we want to overcome our tendencies to dehumanize, which lead to atrocities and genocide, we must look these tendencies square in the face. We must study them honestly, openly, in order to control them. Less than human has garnered lavish praise from scholars. Valerie Curtis, writing in the Journal of Evolutionary Psychology, writes, and I quote, "Books like Smith's should be required reading for all with a social conscience, and his ideas ought to find their way into every school curriculum." The Yale psychologist Paul Bloom calls it, quote, "a beautiful book on an ugly topic." And Charles W. Mills, dean of the field of moral and intellectual philosophy, calls it, and I quote, "a powerful and original work that forces us to recognize that monstrous atrocities are routinely carried out not by monsters, but, alas, by ourselves." Reviewers in the mainstream press, including Barbara Ehrenreich in the LA Times Book Review of Books and David Barabee in the New York Times Book Review, have admired the book for its thoroughness and precision, even while contesting some of Smith's argument. This is why, in the opinion of the jury, a sign of a well-wrought book, because it indicates, in this case, that Less Than Human participates in and inspires a dialogue about what it means to be human and inhuman, and challenges readers to contemplate the very large questions of being and human connection. Professor Smith has written for the New York Times, the USA Today, and other national publications, and he's been a frequent guest on NPR and the BBC and on broadcast television. He recently addressed the G20 summit in Los Cabos, Mexico, and he is co-founder of the New England Institute for Cognitive Science and Evolutionary Studies, an associate professor of philosophy and religious studies at the University of New England. He's been an unflagging student of how human beings make their way in the world, even though that way is often not pretty. He challenges each reader to tinker with our own wiring, to be aware, and he hopes to do better. For his profound insights into the human condition and into the conditions some humans place on others, we present him with the Anisfield-Wolf Book Award for Nonfiction.
This is wonderful. And I deeply appreciate the fact that such a distinguished jury read my book, much less thought it worthy of this great honor. In a moment, I'm going to read to you an excerpt from Less Than Human, which deals, of course, with the atrocities of the past. But I think it's useful to remind ourselves that the point of considering the atrocities of the past is to make a better future. If we can understand what's driven us to do the terrible things that we've done to our fellow human beings, perhaps we can fashion a future with no more Rwandas, no more Auschwitzes, no more Hiroshimas. So, to strike a somber note, I'd like to remind you, sitting here enjoying this event, that halfway around the world, there is a genocide of attrition going on in Sudan, and that genocide is being fueled by dehumanization. I will not go into it more, but those who are interested can speak to my dear colleague Al Sutton, who is the founder of the African Freedom Coalition, and I will have some literature on the table in the reception after this ceremony. So, let me read. The dehumanization of African Americans did not end with the creation of the new nation in 1776, or with the abolition of slavery in 1865. Books and pamphlets published during the latter part of the 19th and early 20th centuries continued to assert that they were beasts. During the 19th century, the new discipline of anthropology gave this racist ideology a veneer of scientific respectability. Some, like the British surgeon Sir William Lawrence, the Harvard geologist Louis Agassiz, and the Philadelphia physician Samuel George Morton, were polygenicists, people who believed that each race had evolved independently of the others, and therefore that black people were a separate species. Quote, "That the Negro is more like a monkey than a European," wrote Lawrence, "cannot be denied as a general observation," end of quote. The German anthropologist Theodor Weitz vividly described the confluence of the polygenesis mindset with exterminationist policy. Writing in 1863, of those who regarded the so-called lower races as subhuman creatures, he remarked, "If there be various species of mankind, there must be a natural aristocracy among them, a dominant white species as opposed to the lower races, who by their origin are destined to serve the nobility of mankind, and may be tamed, trained, and used like domestic animals, or may, according to circumstances, be fattened or used for physiological experiments without any compunction. To endeavor to lead them to a higher morality would be as foolish as to expect that lime trees would by cultivation bear peaches, or the monkey would learn to speak by training. All wars of extermination, whenever the lower species are in the way of the white man, are then not only excusable, but fully justifiable, since a physical existence only is destroyed, which without any capacity for a higher moral development may be doomed to extinction in order to afford space to higher organisms." And he went on to add, this time with delicious irony, that such a theory has many advantages. It flatters our self-esteem by the specific excellence of our moral and intellectual endowment, and saves us the trouble of inquiring for the causes of the differences existing in civilization. The theory has thus obtained many adherents. Whilst there are some who consider this one of the reasons which render the assumption of a specifically higher mental endowment of the white race improbable. Polygenicism was sometimes dubbed the American school because of its popularity in the United States, especially among apologists for slavery. Many Americans fused the Bible with biology to underwrite their racial beliefs in an even more outlandish manner than their 17th and 18th century predecessors had done. Some religious polygenesists believe that Africans are not of Noah's lineage, but were descended from animals that he took aboard the ark. Others believe that blacks were the progeny of the devil, or descendants of a subhuman race that God had fashioned prior to his creation of Adam. A book entitled The Negro, a Beast, published at the turn of the 20th century by the American Book and Bible House, offered a bizarre fusion of scriptural exegesis and biological fantasy. Its anonymous author informed his readers that the serpent of Eden was really a black man, obviously using the word man rather loosely, who had evolved from an ape, whereas Adam and Eve were white people created in God's own image. Beliefs like these fueled the continued violence routinely directed at African Americans during the century or so following the Civil War. The story of Otabenga, a Batwa, pygmy tribesman, provides a heartbreaking illustration of the dehumanization of Africans during this period. Otabenga lived with his wife and children in a village in the vast tract of land in Central Africa, then called the Congo Free State. King Leopold II of Belgium founded the Congo Free State ostensibly to provide aid to the people living there. However, the Congo Free State was anything but free. Leopold ruthlessly exploited its land and its people, draining it of resources like rubber, copper, and ivory, and exterminating approximately 8 million people in the process. The Force Publique, a corps of African mercenaries, enforced the reign of terror. They did their job with gratuitous cruelty. Men, women, and children who failed to meet their quotas were flogged with hippopotamus hide whips or had their hands hacked off with a machete. The hands were then collected in baskets and presented to colonial officials. One eyewitness reported, "A village which refused to provide rubber would be completely swept clean. I saw soldier Molili, then guarding the village of Boyeka, take a big net, put 10 arrested natives in it, attach big stones to the net, and make it tumble into the river. Soldiers made young men rape or kill their own mothers and sisters." Otabenga's village was one of those swept clean by the Force Publique, who murdered his wife and children and sold him to an African slave trader. It was at this point that Samuel Phillips Verner entered the picture. Verner, a missionary and entrepreneur, was in Africa on a mission, but not a religious one. He had recently signed a contract to bring exotic specimens of humanity to St. Louis for a human zoo at the 1904 World's Fair. This was to be a grand ethnographic exhibit, giving visitors an opportunity to ogle at tribal people brought to Missouri from the four corners of the world. Even the old Apache warrior, Goyathle, better known by his Mexican nickname, Geronimo, was going to be on display. Verner was shopping for pygmies. When he discovered Otabenga, he paid off the slave merchant and took the young man to the United States along with seven other Batwa who agreed to join them. When the fair was over, Verner returned them all to their homeland and remained in Africa for a year and a half collecting artifacts and animal specimens. During this time, he and Otabenga became friends. Benga accompanied Verner on his collecting adventures and eventually asked to return with him to the United States. Verner consented. After a brief stint in New York's Museum of Natural History, Otabenga was given a home at the newly opened Bronx Zoo, where he soon became an exhibit, sharing a cage with an orangutan. Few expressed audible objection to the sight of a human being in a cage with monkeys as companions, the New York Times wrote the next day, and there could be no doubt that to the majority, the joint man and monkey exhibition was the most interesting sight in Bronx Park. Spokesmen for the African American community protested. Reverend James H. Gordon pleaded, "Our race, we think, is depressed enough without exhibiting one of us with the apes. We think we are worthy of being considered human beings with souls." And a delegation of black clergymen led by the Reverend R.S. MacArthur addressed the matter in a letter to the mayor of New York. "The person responsible for this exhibition," he wrote, "degrades himself as much as he does the African. Instead of making a beast of this little fellow, he should be put in school for the development of such powers as God gave to him. We send our missionaries to Africa to Christianize the people, and then we bring one here to brutalize him. These protests did not focus entirely on the racially degrading of the character of the exhibit. They were also concerned that the exhibit supported Darwinism, which then as now was anathema to many Christians. Buckling under the pressure of controversy, zoo authorities released Otabenga from his cage and allowed him to wander freely around the zoo, where jeering crowds pursued him. The Times reported, there were 40,000 visitors to the park on Sunday. Nearly every man, woman, and child of this crowd made for the monkey house to see the star attraction in the park, the wild man from Africa. They chased him about the grounds all day, howling, jeering, and yelling. Some of them poked him in the ribs. Others tripped him up. All laughed at him. What happened next is not entirely clear. One sultry summer day, Otabenga decided to undress. Apparently, keepers tried to force him back into his clothes, and he responded by threatening them with a knife. He was promptly transferred to the Howard-colored orphan asylum. Otabenga declined Werner's offer to return him to Africa because, despite his bad experiences in New York, they were nowhere near as bad as the horrors unfolding in his homeland. After a sexual scandal involving a teenage girl, he was transferred to Long Island and eventually to Lynchburg, Virginia, where he attended Lynchburg Seminary and was employed in a tobacco factory. 10 years after arriving in the United States, longing to return to his homeland, but unable to afford a steamship ticket back, Otabenga put a billet through his heart. Thank you.
Thank you. David W. Blight, sesquicentennial. It's a word with which many of us are familiar, and if we aren't now, we soon will be. The 150th anniversary, the sesquicentennial of the Emancipation Proclamation is upon us in 2013. And many books are being published and conferences being planned to commemorate this remarkable event in human history. We are, in fact, hosting such an event at Harvard next May. The signing and implementation of the Emancipation Proclamation was a remarkable event by any measure, but not an uncomplicated one. President Lincoln's thoughts on slavery, freedom, and African Americans evolved over time and were propelled by a sometimes philosophical, sometimes pragmatic calculus of the needs of the nation. No scholar has taught us more or taught me more about the role of memory in the historiography of the Civil War and of the national narrative that emerged from it than has David W. Blight. His 2001 masterpiece called Race and Reunion, The Civil War in American Memory, won all of the most important awards in the field, the Bancroft Prize, the Abraham Lincoln Prize, the Frederick Douglass Prize, and 4 awards from the Organization of American Historians. In this book, he argued what seems so apparent to us now, largely because of his work, that the chief narratives that followed the Civil War were about the courage of the soldiers, about the North and the South, and how their people fought. But as the historian Joan Waugh points out, left out of this account were competing narratives. And I'm quoting, one of those narratives was the story of slavery, emancipation, and freedom, unquote. Blight's mandate has long been to put that narrative back into the official account of the Civil War. In his other work since that book, including Beyond the Battlefield, Race, Memory, and the Civil War, Passages to Freedom, The Underground Railroad and History and Memory, and A Slave No More, two men who escaped to freedom, including their narratives of emancipation, and countless articles, essays, and lectures, Blight has returned to different aspects of this theme of memory and commemoration, and what it means to conflate these subjective accounts with fact and history, and not to recognize them as subjective at all. Now he comes to us with an American oracle, the Civil War and the Civil Rights era, which brings this nuanced exploration into the 20th century. As we approach the sesquicentennial of the proclamation, Blight brings to light how four American writers brought their own perspectives to bear on the centennial of the Civil War, how they grappled with the issues it raised, and how they influenced public memory and commemoration of the war to varying degrees. The four writers Blight features, Southern novelist and essayist Robert Penn Warren, who would come to recant his view of the Civil War as a lost cause, Midwestern historian Bruce Catton, whom Andrew Delbanco calls a sort of literary Norman Rockwell, in part because his capacious works on the Civil War were widely read at the middle of the century, Northern elite and literary critic Edmund Wilson, who looked at the war in terms of his own pacifism, often neglecting the role of race in it, and the Northern Negro novelist and essayist James Baldwin, who was the most acute essayist and thinker on race in the American psyche, hands down, working at that time. Blight said in an interview with the Chronicle of Higher Education that all four, and I quote, argued fiercely with America's tendency toward a progressive, triumphal, sunny sense of history. And all four, his quote continues, demanded that Americans try to see through their well-practiced and comfortable myths about the Civil War and develop a genuine and authentically tragic sense of history. Blight's Yale colleague, the critic and novelist Carol Phillips, said of the book, and I quote, it effortlessly seams together literary analysis, biography, and historical thinking. And in a thoughtful and appreciative review in the New York Review of Books, Andrew Delbanco calls it suggestive and searching. One of our most noted and lauded historians, David Blight is the class of 1954, professor of American history and director of the Gilder Lehrman Center for the Study of Slavery, Resistance, and Abolition at Yale. He has held fellowships at the Huntington Library and the Coleman Center for Writers and Scholars, and is an elected member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Blight is committed to doing the work of a public historian as well, and serves on numerous boards of museums and historical societies, and is a member of the advisory board for the curators of the 9/11 Memorial Museum. As I mentioned before, he has taught me so very much and served as one of my most frequent sources for my documentary, Looking for Lincoln, my book, Lincoln on Race and Slavery, and for our new film project, The African Americans, Many Rivers to Cross. It's my great honor and privilege to present this evening the Anisfield-Wolf Book Award for Nonfiction to my friend and my teacher, David W. Blight.
My goodness. Skip, I actually just wanted to keep sitting there and just let you keep going. I don't want to talk about the book. Let's listen to Skip. If I may borrow a word from Isabella, suppose. What a beautiful word to start, I think, almost every line with. Suppose there was a place that celebrated books. Suppose there was a book award in Cleveland that drew hundreds of people to come celebrate books. Suppose there was a place you could just love and embrace books. Suppose. Well, there is. So I actually celebrate you. This is an amazing statement of the love of books. And there's almost nothing better I can think of than that. I often start my lecture course at Yale by holding Frederick Douglass's narrative in my hand, and I walk out into the, you know, it's got 200 or 300 students in it, and I walk out into the audience among the students, and I sort of embarrass myself, and I make them squirm. I hold the book like it's a newborn child, and I try to get them to think about how they too can love books, and they get squirmy, and then I finally go back and start the class. But, thank you to Mary Louise Hahn, who obviously is the genius behind this organization, and to you, Mr. Richard, this foundation that does this award. The American Civil War, as most of us know, at least in a bypassing way, is commemorated all over our landscape, all over our cities. Every town, green or center in America, has a Civil War monument of some kind. You have an extraordinary Soldiers and Sailors monument right here in the middle of Cleveland. I actually just visited it today. Extraordinary monument. Unlike, actually, most I've seen. And there are a lot of them. It is our most vexing experience that we've had to try to process. I chose the four writers that Skip so well described for this book, and a fifth, actually, Ralph Ellison, who's the subject of my epilogue. And by the way, my epilogue on Ralph Ellison was in part inspired by a scene that Arnold Rampersad depicts in his magnificent biography of Ralph Ellison, and I just had the chance to tell Arnold that. You'll have to read the book to know what I meant by that. Robert Penn Warren, in one of those so quotable lines from his little book called Legacy of the Civil War, stops for a breath at one point and he says, "The Civil War draws us as an oracle, darkly unriddled and portentous, of personal as well as national fate." Now, that's a mouthful. But if there is an event, an epoch, a turning point in American history that may indeed be our oracle, the place we go for wisdom, the place we go to ask questions about who we are, the place we go because we always seem to be still fighting over its legacies, it is probably the Civil War. Now, just where that oracle is, or what it is, whether it's in a text, a favorite text, whether it's a place, a monument, a memorial, the Lincoln Memorial, Stone Mountain, the Shaw Memorial in Boston, is anyone's choice. But it is that event in some ways that we go back to. Now, James Baldwin, I had a great time writing this book, in part because you don't get to do this very often. I just wrote about those writers I'd always wanted to write about. I'd been quoting them, using them for epigraphs, just using them for years. So finally, I just decided I'm just going to write about them and see what shape the book takes. Baldwin, though, was to me the most revealing. I'd always basically just quoted Baldwin, plucked passages out of Baldwin, which we all do. But Baldwin the essayist, Baldwin the nonfiction voice of the civil rights movement, is something everyone should go back and revisit. In the collection Nobody Knows My Name, or in the collection his previous nonfiction collections, or most famously in The Fire Next Time, Baldwin made himself the voice that was constantly asking, why can't Americans remember slavery? Why don't they want to face their history with racism? Why don't they want to look back at the emancipation process? Why don't they want to look back at Reconstruction? Why won't they? And he often would do it in his typically, Skip knows this, he actually interviewed Baldwin, in his quicksilver, you know, quick-fire, rapid-fire method, often trying to appeal and get under the skin of white guilt. But he left us so many passages about how we remember and forget. One of my favorites is one of the simplest. It's in a 1962 essay where he says, "Too often when Americans use words about their history, they use the words to cover up the sleeper, but never to wake him up." It's almost perfect. You know, some metaphors just come out of some writers and they're almost perfect. The past we so often, we're all guilty of this sometimes. What past do you want to claim to be part of? What narrative do you want to live in? A past that helps me sleep at night. A past that makes me feel good. Tell me the old story and make me feel good again. Not the past that makes us wake up with nightmares. I just want to end with a quick story from Baldwin. I'll read it. It's the last two pages of my chapter on James Baldwin. Baldwin has just flown back from England. It's March 1965. I still have a problem getting into the 20th century. Sorry. Baldwin had been in England at the University of Cambridge. Some of you remember this or know this. He had just debated William F. Buckley at the Cambridge Union before 600 Cambridge students. He wiped the floor with Buckley had no chance in that debate. The topic at that time was the American dream. Is it at the expense of the Negro? I mean, you can actually see it on YouTube. Pull it up. You can actually watch the Buckley-Baldwin debate. It's just stunning. At any rate, he's just flown back from England, and he's on his way to a special event. On February 21st, 1965, 3 days after Baldwin debated Buckley in England, Malcolm X was assassinated at the Apollo Theater in Harlem. 2 weeks after that, 600 civil rights marchers were brutally beaten by sheriff's deputies and state police on the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, the incident which came to be known as Bloody Sunday, one of the most important markers in the civil rights movement's history. If anything, now, the fire next time, that manifesto of what might come to be in America if we didn't face this past, the fire next time, published in 1963, massive bestseller, by the way, 9 months number one on the New York Times bestseller list, seemed a bit too prophetic. By late March, Baldwin was in Selma himself to participate in the voter registration drive and ultimately in the famous march from Selma to Montgomery, March 25 to 29, 1965. Baldwin joined the throng as it swelled along the highways, 25, 30,000 strong from all over America, and finally reached the old capital of the Confederacy, Montgomery. If we wish to see just what was at stake in the clashing versions of the history and memory of the Civil War era, with all their resonances in the Civil Rights era, which is what this book is really about, a small remembrance in one of Baldwin's 1965 essays tells the tale. The voice of the Civil Rights Movement, which is what he was being called at that point, not Malcolm X, Baldwin, the voice was powerfully alive in this essay, which he called Unnameable Objects, Unspeakable Crimes. And Baldwin published it first in Ebony Magazine in August 1965. You can find it many other places now. Baldwin charted in this piece the ways whites and blacks had forged segregated and deeply suspicious historical memories of each other. And drawing on Cold War imagery, he argued that Americans had built what he called a color curtain in their lives and in their hearts and in their historical consciousness, which, as he put it, may prove to be more deadly than that iron curtain of which we speak so much. Baldwin used a refrain about distance, as he called it, between whites and blacks, between whites and themselves, and between the stories within which people claim to be living. As the celebratory marchers arrived in the center of Montgomery, Baldwin noticed that the Confederate flag was flying from the Capitol dome, and that the federalized Alabama National Guard, ordered to protect the marchers, as he put it, wore little Confederate flags on their jackets. And all along the road, wrote Baldwin, quoting him, older black men and women who have endured unspeakable oppression for so long waved and cheered and wept. In the white section of town, Baldwin saw businessmen, as he puts it, on balconies jeering, their maids in back doors standing silent. And then he describes a, quote, beige-colored woman standing on the street, a bit nervous, who suddenly steps off the curb and joins them. And with a small American flag in his hand, Baldwin marched next to Harry Belafonte, his fellow Harlem-born comrade, who had also happened to be a U.S. Navy veteran of World War II. White secretaries in upstairs office windows kept extending thumbs down signs, says Baldwin, to the marchers, until suddenly many of them saw the stunningly handsome reigning matinee idol, Harry Belafonte, in the crowd. When they saw that beautiful cat, says Baldwin, these women demonstrated that America was the most desperately schizophrenic of republics. Baldwin's storytelling prose and his insight were never in better form. This was vintage James Baldwin. Race, sex, and his country, all on extraordinary display and subject to his scorching, ironic pen. Those young women in the windows, Baldwin declared, quote, could only look forward to an alliance with one of those jeering businessmen. And they were, he says, female, a word which in the context of the color curtain has suffered the same fate as the word male. Baldwin did not miss his chance. When those girls saw Harry Belafonte, he writes, a collision occurred in them so visible as to be at once hilarious and unutterably sad. At one moment, the thumbs were down. They were barricaded within their skins. At the next moment, those downturned thumbs flew up to their mouths. Their faces changed, and exactly like Bobby Soxers, they oohed and they aahed and they moaned. God knows what was happening in the minds and hearts of those girls. Perhaps, concludes Baldwin, they just wanted to be free. Out of imagery that only Baldwin might have actually seen, in a world historical moment, amid the joy and solemnity of the spectacular Selma March, he made great art out of all the real people around him, barricaded in their skins. On the eve of the centennial of the surrender at Appomattox, in the city where the Confederacy was born, Baldwin, as he'd been doing for years, tried to kill that old story, asking everyone to see into a new history as they never had before. And after all, he too just wanted to be loved and just wanted to be free. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, David. Thank you so much. Last but not least, ladies and gentlemen, Arnold Rampersad. Arnold Rampersad was driven to write his PhD dissertation at Harvard on W.E.B. Du Bois by what he felt was lacking in prior attempts to render the great man's life. With characteristic generosity, Rampersad said, and I quote, while the historians who had written about him had done good jobs, I believe that they had missed his genuine essence, which in my opinion is the grandly poetic imagination he brought to the business of seeing and describing Black America and America itself, unquote. From the vantage point of knowing and admiring Professor Rampersad for years and years and years, I would say that my dear friend shares Du Bois's genuine essence. Through the lens of his biographical subjects, this premier biographer has brought into sharpest focus not just his subjects, but Black America and indeed America itself. Professor Rampersad was born in Trinidad and Tobago and calls his early literary education colonial. In those early years, he was certainly not a student of Du Bois, Langston Hughes, or the Harlem Renaissance, the writing that would subsequently shape him professionally. Perhaps it is his sublimely cosmopolitan perspective on the United States and on its literature that gives him such a clear-eyed view of it, though that may be too easy a formulation. In any case, suffice it to say that his work really is without compare. The word magisterial is often used in conjunction with biographies, so the effect of the word has diminished somewhat. But I want to restore it, as I can think of no better word than that to describe the march and authority of his four masterworks: The Art and Imagination of W.E.B. Du Bois, The Life of Langston Hughes in two volumes, Jackie Robinson, a biography, and Ralph Ellison, a biography. The first volume of the Hughes biography was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize. The Ellison biography was a finalist for the National Book Award. In recognition of his contributions not only to African-American biography, but also to the genre of biography itself, he recently received the 2012 Bio Award of the Biographers International Organization. William Grimes called Rampersad's biography of Ralph Ellison fair to a fault. Rampersad's is a judicious and honest appraisal of a most difficult and complex figure in the American literary pantheon. Grimes puts it humorously, and I quote, "Biographers enter into a kind of marriage with their subjects. Usually the relationship is happy, but it sometimes happens that the biographer wakes up one morning after years of cohabitation, looks over at the other person, and sees a stranger, an unlikable stranger at that," unquote. Whether we see Ellison as unlikable and aggressive, or sad and bereft, or both, Rampersad presents a fully fleshed out character in this work. The temptation to lionize the man must have been great. No other novel had more influence over African-American writing in the latter half of the 20th century than Invisible Man. Another critic called Rampersad's treatment of Langston Hughes unsparing and sympathetic. Those are the qualities, if you think about it, ladies and gentlemen, of unvarnished truth-telling. And it's those qualities that make Arnold Rampersad's work so powerful, so very, very important. In addition to being a biographer without peer, Rampersad is also a noted editor and anthologist with superbly edited editions, including The Collected Poems of Langston Hughes and The Big Sea, an autobiography of Langston Hughes, Alain Locke's The New Negro, Voices of the Harlem Renaissance, Library of America editions of Richard Wright's Black Boy and Native Son, and a collection entitled Slavery in the Imagination, which he edited with Deborah McDowell down at the University of Virginia. He's also the co-author of Arthur Ashe's fetching memoir entitled Days of Grace. Rampersad is the Sarah Kimball Hart Professor in the Humanities Emeritus at Stanford, and he's held fellowships from the MacArthur, the Guggenheim, and Rockefeller Foundations. He's an elected member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the American Philosophical Society. In 2010, he received the National Humanities Medal, which was presented to him by President Obama in a ceremony at the White House in 2011, the nation's highest honor conferred upon a humanist. Arnold Rampersad has been a model and a mentor for literary scholars for more than three decades, and I include myself among that number, among those of us indebted to him for his insistence upon the universal, universality of standards, of truth with a capital T, and beauty with a capital B, as Du Bois would have it. He combines the fullest embrace of his biographical subject's humanity with the courage to confront the fullest range of that humanity, qualities that are all too rare even among our most lauded biographers, qualities absolutely necessary to the task of responsibly representing another person's life in all of its beauty and its darkness, over the full range of its humanity and ours. That is the essence of the art of biography, and it is that challenge that Arnold Rampersad has so successfully confronted squarely, honestly, and always most eloquently. It gives me an enormous amount of pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, and a privilege to present Arnold Rampersad with the Anisfield-Wolf Lifetime Achievement Award. Thank you.
do agree that the skip should just have kept on going and going, and and I would not have had to say a word here. I should be the first, I think, to drink out of this glass of water. It's wonderful to be in Cleveland. I remember I'm a Bowling Green alumnus. And I also spent several weeks, months maybe, many, many years ago when I was working on the first volume of The Life of Langston Hughes, trying to track down the footsteps of that wonderful man during his 4 years at Central High in Cleveland. So it gives me a great deal of pleasure being back. So thank you very, very much, Professor Gates, Skip, my friend. And thank you also to all the members of the exceptionally distinguished jury, including you and also the wonderful poet Rita Dove, that decided to make me the honoree this year. I was very pleased to receive a wonderful letter from Mr. Richard giving me the news, confirming the news. And I thank all the people who helped to make my visit pleasurable, easy, comfortable, including, perhaps above all, Mary Louise Hahn, who has been already praised tonight. I recall quite vividly how thrilling it was in 1987 to learn that the first volume of my Langston Hughes biography had been selected by the Anisfield-Wolf Foundation as one of its honored books that year. I knew the pioneering role the foundation had played in recognizing how crucial it was and is to encourage studies having to do with race and American culture. Of course, I could hardly have imagined then that some 25 years later, I would be standing on this stage as the recipient of so distinguished an award from the same foundation. Certainly, understanding race has been an essential challenge in my own biographical work, whether my subject was Du Bois, Hughes, Ashe, Robinson, or Ellison. Each of these men experienced and understood race in a different way. For the prophetic Du Bois, I was going to say Dr. Du Bois, but let's call him Du Bois, it was an all-consuming issue with which he wrestled his entire life. He even subtitled one of his books, The Autobiography of a Race Concept. For Langston Hughes, a genial man, but not without his demons, needless to say, race was a topic engaged in public mainly from an angle that emphasized not rage or recrimination, although he certainly had his fiery moments, but his emphasis on the idea of the beauty, historicity, and spirituality of black people. For the highly sensitive Arthur Ashe, race, by his own declaration, was a source of pain more intense than even the disease of AIDS that took his life prematurely in 1993. For Jackie Robinson, race was first barriers of segregation to be hurdled spectacularly, as he did in 1947, but then in later life, a gritty struggle for dignity and effectiveness that he waged in the spheres of politics, business, and civil rights. For Ralph Ellison, race was an issue to be adjudicated within the context of a complex American national identity that was founded on certain principles and ideals enshrined legally in what Ellison reverentially called our, quote, sacred documents. Now, starting my own doctoral work in English and American literature in the United States in 1968, as Skip has talked about, I was swept along, as so many of us were in the 1960s and early 1970s, by the force of social and political changes involving race that were transforming American culture. Choosing a dissertation topic, I turned away almost instinctively from traditional literary criticism. Much as I loved poetry, I did not want to write a book of literary criticism of the traditional kind. Dimly recognizing what I thought was a crisis of representation where black Americans were concerned, I turned toward biography out of a sense that biography offered an almost uniquely effective way to address what I've called a crisis of representation. When I found myself seared to the bone by passages about race in Du Bois's 1903 classic, The Souls of Black Folk, for example, but then read the major existing scholarly books on Du Bois, I couldn't see the face, the mind, the sensibility of the man who had moved me so deeply. Their Du Bois was emphatically not my Du Bois, so I dipped as deeply as I could then into biography. The Du Bois papers were closed to me, so I tried my hand at what is called intellectual biography. I think that what I didn't fully understand in starting out was the near absolute rarity of black biography in those days. That is, biographies of black Americans by either whites or blacks. I didn't fully understand that in a real sense, biography simply wasn't supposed to happen to black Americans. Just as black Americans weren't supposed, indeed in some cases weren't allowed, to live in certain neighborhoods or to hold certain positions. In The Souls of Black Folk, Du Bois had written about the paradox of being a black American, of possessing no, quote, true self-consciousness, but being instead doomed always to see oneself only as white's so on. Du Bois dwelt on the contempt of the white world that seemed to think, in his words, that, quote, between man and cattle, God created a tertium quid, a third something, and called it Negro. Now, David Smith has covered some of this territory, but American history bore out the accuracy of this mordant observation. One highly regarded 19th century book of science argued that blacks constituted not a different race, but an altogether separate species from whites, so that, quote, the Negro was closer to the chimpanzee and the orangutan than he was to the Caucasian. A Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court declared that as far as the Founding Fathers were concerned, blacks from the start had, quote, been regarded as beings of an inferior order, and altogether unfit to associate with the white race, either in social or political relations, and so far unfit that they had no rights which the white man was bound to respect, end quote. The US Supreme Court ruled in 1896 that social contact between blacks and whites was so distasteful a proposition inherently that separate but equal accommodations for blacks and whites were perfectly legal. The era of Jim Crow was made legal. With such attitudes nationally held, a biography of a black man or woman amounted not only to a kind of violation of social taboos, but also perhaps to a violation of intellectual propriety itself. For many decades, Frederick Douglass seemed to be the only black person deemed worthy of a substantial biography, that is, one published by an established house. This situation persisted well beyond the desegregation decision of 1954 and the turmoil of the civil rights movement. Finally, according to my recognition, in 1972, the historian Lewis Harlan published the first of his two volumes on Booker T. Washington that would win him a Pulitzer Prize. The silence enveloping black writers began to break. In 1973 came a biography of the novelist Richard Wright by the Frenchman Michel Farbe, followed by a biography in 1977 of the novelist Toriel Hurston by the American scholar Robert Hemingway. And in 86 and 1988 came my two volumes on Hughes. Aided by a voluminous archive left behind by Hughes, I try to tell, through the lens of one crucial life, the African-American story as it had existed and exists at a certain social level. I try to do justice to the complexity that had been discounted over the centuries in the representation of American racial reality. The picture is quite different now. The 1990s saw a steady rise of prize-winning biographies of black Americans by writers such as Taylor Branch and William McFeely. In 1994 and 2001, David Levering Lewis won Pulitzers for each of his two volumes on Du Bois. This year, a biography by the late Manning Marable won the Pulitzer Prize in the field of history. This surge in biographical writing about African Americans is, I think, a dependable index to the shifting meaning of race in American culture and also to the risen dignity of Black Americans. Biographies document and complicate our sense of the individual human condition. They are the opponents of facelessness, of existential emptiness, of what has been called social death. Insofar as race remains a major issue among us and will continue to remain major among us, biography, I would say, is almost uniquely qualified as an effective response to the harm that racism in its various forms has caused and continues to cause in so many aspects of our lives. I am deeply satisfied to have played even a small role in this unfolding story of change, and again, I am certainly profoundly grateful to the Anisfield-Wolf Foundation for honoring me as it has done today. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Skip, and thank you as well, of course, to our 2012 honorees, whose imagination and artistry have transported us to other places and times. We'll fondly remember this evening. I have to say, I've been doing this for many years. It's been a very cerebral and memorable evening. I'm not sure I'm going to sleep that well tonight. There's a lot of disturbing but important images for us all to think about and ponder. Of course, we wouldn't be here without the diligence and leadership of you and our hardworking jury, Skip. As jury chair, you have guided this tribute for the past 16 years, and we're really very grateful. I think you know that. Our appreciation extends to your colleagues on this eminent panel, Rita Dove, Joyce Carol Oates, Steven Pinker, and Simon Sharma. And I know that Edith Anisfield-Wolf would be very pleased and proud to know that the flame of knowledge and understanding that she fanned burns brighter than ever, thanks to your stewardship. The person who's been associated with this event, who's been recognized a few times tonight, but deserves to be recognized a third time by me, who's been associated with this event as long as Skip has, is the one and only Mary Louise Hahn. My dear friend and my cherished mentor, who, and this isn't in the script, but as she'll tell you, I always chide and refer to as my friend from across the river, because I'm from the old line state of Maryland. That's the Mason-Dixon line, for those of you who don't know that. And she's from across the river in Virginia. And so we share the Potomac River as that thread that binds us together, along with many other threads. I wish you could all see this charming, genteel lady in action. Her drive and devotion are unmatched as she organizes this evening, attending, as you know, to every detail, overlooking nothing, and doing it all with that wonderful smile. She's been serving as our Anisfield-Wolf consultant since 1995, and she helped organize the first public ceremony in 1997. And now, regrettably, she's decided to relinquish her Anisfield-Wolf duties. I guess you wore her out, Skip. Mary Louise, when the good Lord made you, he broke the mold. You are simply irreplaceable, and this event won't be the same without you. Of course, one of the reasons you're irreplaceable is I don't know who else can control this guy. I'll worry about that starting tomorrow. But would you please stand one more time and take a bow? I also want to acknowledge Cindy Schultz and our public affairs team, which is second to none, and all the other Cleveland Foundation staff members who pitched in, including those here tonight as volunteers. Thank you very much. As always, your teamwork makes it all happen for us at the Foundation. And we're lucky to have the support of our friends at Playhouse Square, whom we thank for accommodating us this evening. Another valued partner is the Baker Nord Center for the Humanities at Case Western Reserve University, where David Blight spoke yesterday, and afterwards the center hosted a reception for him. David Smith spoke yesterday at the Beechwood branch of the Cuyahoga Public County Public Library, another supporter deserving our thanks. We also enjoy a close relationship with Cleveland Public Library, which since 2003 has housed the complete and ever-expanding collection of Anisfield-Wolf Book Award winners. If you haven't been there and seen the collection, you really need to go. Our book sale partner is a cultural exchange which brings multicultural arts programming to children throughout Cleveland. My friend Debbie McCam and her fine staff have supported every single award ceremony. I hope you caught David Blight and David Smith with Mike McIntyre on IdeaStream WCPN's The Sound of Ideas this morning. I did. It was a great show. If you missed them, you may have heard Arnold Rampersad, and Skip Gates today on Around Noon with Dee Perry. Tomorrow, our community will again hear from our two nonfiction winners. At noon, David Blight will address the City Club of Cleveland's Friday Forum, and David Smith will speak at 12:45 p.m. at the Inamori International Center for Ethics and Excellence at Case Western Reserve University. Now, a duty I look forward to all year long, it's really an honor, not a duty, it's time to present our honorees with their 2012 Anisfield-Wolf Book Awards. Each author receives a monetary stipend and a unique symbol of achievement. A signature glasswork over there, in the colors of their book jackets, handcrafted exclusively for the Anisfield-Wolf Book Awards by the artisans of Streets of Manhattan, a creative glass studio here in Cleveland. I'd like to ask everyone to stand for a final round of, I'd like to ask our honorees to stand for a final round of applause, and would our honorees please come up and receive their prizes.